My name is Philip J. Ruce, Philip with one L, P-H-I-L-I-P, J. Ruce, R-U-C-E. I'm the director of the estate planning team at Stone Arch Law Office. Estate planning is the process by which we take your values, we take the things that are important to you, we take into account your physical possessions, money, your family members, and we find a cohesive and value-driven way to make that happen in preparation for death. I think oftentimes people think about the death part a little bit too much. It's really focusing on the things that are important to you with the idea that you're going to have security and peace of mind. Here's the things I would typically tell someone to do. Take an inventory of your assets. Understand what it is you have. Take an inventory of your people. Think of the people who are important to you. Think of, is there anybody that you would want to care and support more than others, or are there other causes? Are there things like charities that are important to you, or other causes like that? And then value-wise, think of the things that are important to you. For example, if we were working with a young family who had young children, and if education was an important part of their family, we would want to make sure we create a plan where not just are the children cared for physically, but also can we impart those values to those children through the management of that estate? Can we make sure we're paying for college or whatever it is? A very important part of this, and something I always want to emphasize, there are many do-it-yourself options out there. This is not a one-size-fits-all process. This is something that I absolutely recommend working with a professional, if not our office, another attorney that you trust, but have this done in a way where you can feel secure that it's done correctly and that things will actually happen the way that you want them to happen. I think the biggest value that the legal professional is going to bring is making sure you're thinking about the things that you didn't realize you need to think about. I don't know that we've had a meeting where someone hasn't said, at least at some point, oh yeah, I didn't think about that. And that's really the idea here, is we want to guide you through the things that you're going to miss. Also, Minnesota laws are different than other states' laws. It's a state-by-state thing. So when it comes to what we're controlling and what we're trying to make sure happens, or maybe more importantly doesn't happen, there are very specific ways to make sure that happens and to make that represented in the document in a way that's doable and workable. When we work with a client, we do ask for some preparation. It's pretty minimal. We would like to know, you know, have you thought about who would be the people who manage the estate, like your executor? Certainly, if you have young children, do you have some preferences for people who would manage that? Have some idea of the money and what you have. Do you have a house? Do you have a couple parcels of rental real estate, retirement plans? What is it that you have? From there, your legal team's going to kind of take it from there. They're going to sit down with you for an hour to an hour and a half, really get a feel for what it is, again, that's important to you, understand your people, make some recommendations you may not have thought about when it comes to who's in charge. We go through that with people. And we're not going to make people change things, but we might point out some reasons to maybe switch things around a little bit. And there's a number of other issues that can come up that people don't always realize, such as tax issues or controlling this process called probate. It's the administrative court proceeding where we make an estate work. So I would say that depending on the team a little bit, depending on the attorney with whom you work, your preparation isn't as much as you probably think it needs to be to get started. One thing I made this term up, but there's one thing that we call the waterfall of distributions, which is every single distribution or gift you make in your will, there has to be a backup for it. So one of the most complicated probates that we ever had to do with a single line, and that line said, I give to so-and-so my truck. And this was about a 20-year-old will, and they no longer had that truck, and we were trying to understand what this person meant. Did they mean any truck I had at death? Did they mean just this specific truck, and if I don't have this truck, this gift goes away? Did they mean this truck or the value of this truck? Like, what is it that they really wanted? And not only that, the person they were giving it to, after the death of the person for whom we were doing this probate, That person died about 6 months later, sadly, but there was no backup. So where does the truck go? Does it just go to that person's estate? Was it meant to disappear and go with the rest of the estate? So we always want to make sure it goes to that next level. So I give this money to this individual, and if they're not around this, and if they're not around this, and then eventually it pools down to kind of a last resort charity or something of that nature. So we see that a surprise that we need to really have solid backups. We see that pretty regularly. I believe that your legal professional is going to be very good at being specific and making sure things are very identifiable and making sure, even if you don't see it in the document, that there's backups and kind of last resorts. So when we're working with a will document, what we're actually working with is a court document. We're working with instructions for the court system. And like it or not, and it's not always a great thing, of course, but there's a certain language that the court system uses. So when you look at a will, your attorney, if you have a good attorney, they're not going to be using legalese with you. They're going to speak in regular human being language with you. But when you look at that document, it's almost certainly going to have some legalese in there. Your attorney will explain what that means. But the reason is that document goes to a judge, and these things mean something, and they mean something very specific. So do you really understand what it is your will says? That's very important. Whether you're doing it yourself or working with an attorney, make sure you understand it. And there are some misconceptions about wills in particular. There's folks who think that if you write a will document, that you're going to avoid court, that you're going to avoid this probate process. And that's not what wills do. Wills are a court document that control this probate process. Probate is the administrative court proceeding where when I die, my stuff gets divided up. So we need to appoint someone who's in charge. If I have no documents at all, we have to use the statutes, and I don't really get to choose that. If I have documents, we're going to nominate my first choice, my second choice, my third choice. Someone in line will accept being the personal representative. Some people call that the executor. And then they are empowered by the court to sell the house, to distribute the money, to do the things they need to do. With no will document, we use these default rules. You don't get to choose. There's just rules out there. It's going to happen that way. We want to overwrite those typically and overwrite them well and thoroughly with a court document of your own, and that's what your will is. It's a standardized process. If you don't have a will document, they're called the intestacy statutes. That's not important. What's important is they're created by the legislature. And interestingly, they're created largely from the default rules you would have wanted from an early 20th century farm family. So we want to keep the property going in a certain line. If there's a remarriage, if there's children from another marriage, if it's a blended family and there's half siblings, the rules are set in stone and they are likely not what you think they are. In fact, if you own your home individually, not as a joint owner, just I own my house in my name and then later on I got married, my wife will not automatically get that house. She'll get to stay there. She won't be forced to move out. She'll get what's called a life estate. And then when she wants to sell that house, my kids, hopefully they're not minors, will have to sign off on that sale because they have an interest in that, kind of like an old farm, like as you picture that to be. So that's the mentality we have to take when we're thinking about what the default rules do. And for most families, absolutely, 100% most families, that's not the right fit. We want to overwrite those with something that's much more applicable to you and your loved ones and your values. You want to have a choice in what happens, and you want to feel secure that you understand what's going to happen. So it's one thing to choose it. It's another thing to know, you know, pretty solidly that that's actually what's going to happen. So I think that underscores the reason to have a plan. I also think that underscores to be very, very careful of do-it-yourself solutions. When we put those through probate, it's not always a very smooth process. So just be careful, do what's important to you, understand your values. Do you feel comfortable that those are going to be realized if we actually had to use that document? The time, I would say that the important time to start estate planning is when you either have assets for which you're responsible or people for whom you're responsible. So once I'm married and I want to make sure things are going to go to that person, and if I want to have some additional controls on there, I can. Certainly once I have young children and I want to make sure that the right people will care for them, the right values will be instilled in my children, the right financial values will be instilled in my children. Once you're responsible for another person and you want to make sure that they receive the care that you want them to receive, that's when the time really is to get planning. If we wanted a hard start point, I would say absolutely young kids. Don't feel guilty if you haven't done it. If you're watching this and you're in your 70s and you just have never gotten around to it, I would say 80%+ of the people that stop by our office, Stone Arch Law Office, 80 or more, regardless of age, are doing this for the first time. We see that way more than people who are coming back to get it redone. That said, it is a document that once you do it, you gotta stay up on it a little bit. Make sure you still have the relationships with the people. Make sure, you know, you might have assets that grow and appreciate. Does this still serve what you had when you wrote it? To amend a will or a trust document, there's another tool we haven't talked about, I'll talk about that. But to amend a will or other estate planning document, if you use the attorney who drafted that document, they're going to be very familiar with it. They're going to completely understand what it says already, and the amount of review they're going to have to do for that document is going to be pretty minimal. It's probably a few hundred bucks to make a change. If you use a new attorney or you had a do-it-yourself document that maybe shouldn't be amended, it should probably be done correctly for the first time, you're probably going to almost start over in some ways. But again, what's the value of knowing that it's going to represent the things that are important to you? The four things that I think we need to focus on when we're doing planning is we want to focus on, do we like the default rules or are we trying to replace those? Do we care about this probate process, this court process called probate? Do we care enough about the feelings of our family to make sure that this is solid enough where they'll absolutely understand it? And then also, do we have any big tax worries? The first one we've touched on a little bit, default rules, they're out there. That's what's happening. Do we want to overwrite that and make sure it's happening on our terms with our values, with our family, and make sure things happen the way we want them to happen? The next one is this process called probate, which again, probate is the administrative court proceeding where if I die, my stuff has to get divided up. We have to have somebody who's in charge, make sure the right people get things in the right proportion, make sure bills are paid. There's creditors out there, they have to get paid off. But believe it or not, probate's sort of optional if you do some planning beforehand. The default tool that I think everybody thinks about is this will document, which again, a will document is the court document that the judge uses to determine what we're gonna do. That's the thing that overrides our default rules. That's the thing we're gonna follow in probate. But there's a way around that if you do a little bit of preliminary planning earlier on. And the tool you're gonna hear about most with this, and folks who are watching this may have heard of a revocable trust or a living trust or a revocable living trust, they're all the same thing. And what this is, it's a family entity. It sounds like it's something for wealthy people, and it isn't. The most common client we see has three kids in a house who's trying to avoid this probate process. It's a family entity, and what we wanna do is we wanna make sure our stuff passes into this thing, whether it's by a beneficiary designation on a brokerage account, whether it's a real estate deed that we file with the county, whatever happens that we want, think of it as a funnel. We want to get our stuff to pass into this thing. Anything that passes into this thing is going to be controlled by our private family agreement, which is our trust document. And if we have this created through this entity, we actually get to bypass the court system. And the issues we have with probate, it's expensive, it costs money. The University of Minnesota Extension Office says it can cost up to 3% of an estate. That varies from probate to probate. It's very public. If I have anything in my family that I want to keep confidential or just kind of, it's not a secret, I'm just uncomfortable people knowing about it, maybe we want to avoid that. And then it's much faster. Probate is right now trying to get a court hearing. It's 6 to 9 months out. If we want to sell that family home and just get that money to the kids, if we have this revocable trust and we can avoid probate, we can do it right away, day one, if we wanted to. Next is avoiding relationship pain or relationship hurt family dynamics. We have an example recently of a family that they have three children. One of them is a very successful surgeon and makes hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. The other two children are also very successful in their fields. They're doing great, they're teachers, but the income between those three is very uneven. And in the parent's mind, they want to help the other two a little more if something happens, because the other one financially is very set. And you can absolutely do that. You can make uneven distributions. We do it all the time. But one really important thing to remember is talking about the plan. At our office here at Stone Arch Law Office, we like to say that these things work better in the light of day. So if you can communicate why you're doing something, that goes a long way. Otherwise, we know that money isn't love, but it can feel that way when there's no explanation. So even though the surgeon can probably understand why they're getting less, if no one talked to this person about this, it can feel like they were cut out. And that can be very painful, and it can leave a mess behind that you can't really fix because you're not there to fix it. So we want to make sure we're doing things in a logical way that has an explanation and that's understandable for the family. And the last thing that I always want to touch on is there may be significant tax issues depending on what you have and how you have it and what you've done with your assets during life. Retirement accounts are a good example. Most Americans have an IRA or a 401k or something of that nature. If that money is tax deferred, which it usually is, when the beneficiary takes that out, they have to claim that money as income. So they have to pay taxes at whatever their tax rate is. A higher tax rate is going to pay more taxes on that money. There's also rules on how quickly it has to be taken out. So for example, spouses typically can take it out in little tiny pieces called a required minimum distribution over their lives. But adult children have to take the whole thing out in 10 years. So if they're higher income, we want to plan around that a little bit. How much are they going to have to claim every year? It doesn't always require a lot of complex calculations, but we can just understand this person is going to pay a little more than this person. What do we want to leave to whom? If there's been lifetime gifting, there can be capital gains taxes. And then we hear about in the news estate taxes all the time, federal estate taxes. Minnesota has its own state estate tax. Some folks call these death taxes. The exemptions, the tax-free amount on the federal is very high. On the state level, it's $3 million, which sounds like a lot. But once you factor in life insurance, which counts, once you factor in retirement accounts, the home, if one spouse dies, the other spouse has everything, including the life insurance money, including their own life insurance, we can bump into that pretty quickly. So we want to just keep an eye out for those estate tax issues as well. The first step, if you're looking to get some planning done, is just, again, give some thought to what it is you have and who the people are in your life. I would contact a professional to get started. They'll guide you on what you need to do. You don't have to be super ready before you make that call. Contact a professional if you'd like, and if it makes sense for you. For most families, it does. Be very careful of do-it-yourself solutions. There's legal jargon, but legalese in those, you really want to make sure you understand what it is. These rules, again, are state-specific, so you want to make sure you understand what the default rules are, or if you don't care about that, your legal professional will guide you through that, and it'll be a piece of cake. If you're interested in learning more information, if you visit stonearchlaw.com, Stone Arch like the bridge, L-A-W.com, we have a ton of informational videos. We have ebooks, free resources. You can download and learn quite a bit about wills versus trust, whatever you want. We got a lot on there for you. I graduated from law school in 2008. I spent 6 years in the trust department of banks. So I was at a large bank and then a small bank. And then I went into private practice about 9 years ago. And the team has grown. We've got some very compassionate, very kind people working here. It's a very approachable process, more so than people think. I'm very proud that one of the things I hear the most when people leave is that was easier than I thought, because it should be. It should be something that's accessible, understandable for just families, regular families. You don't gotta be a billionaire to feel like you need to talk to an attorney about this. It should be something that's easy. How do we make it more accessible? How do we make it more understandable and feel like it isn't this? For many, actually most families that come in here, I think we're the first time they've ever had to talk to a lawyer. There's certainly never any criminal things, and they may not be business owners and they haven't had a divorce. They've never had to talk to an attorney. So it can feel, I think, kind of intimidating. Fortunately, I think through the process it comes out that, oh, this is actually a very good feeling to have this done and to go through it. I love what we do. I love the team in particular, I think is just fantastic. I'm so lucky to have these people working with me. I think the satisfaction of a plan being done and done properly, and you can almost see people's shoulders kind of as they're leaving, that's very exciting. That's a very good feeling.